Welcome to the Indian Silicon Valley podcast. I'm your host, Jivraj, and today I have with me the founder of India's largest used car marketplace. Join me in welcoming Mr. Vikram Chopra, the co-founder and CEO of Cars24. Thank you so much, Vikram, for joining me. Absolutely delighted to be hosting you today.
Thank you, Jivraj. Excited to be talking to you.
Great to hear that. And to get us started, I want to focus on the very first part of your life, right? Where you were just finding out what you want to do. And you went through these traditional, so to say, circumstances, trajectories in life. And then you went the founder route, took that leap of faith and had one startup before Cars24, right? So if you can perhaps get a prelude to your life before Cars24 and understand what motivated you to take the founder journey, I think that'll set us up perfectly well for the conversation ahead.
My life before starting up was fairly simple and straightforward, right? A formula-led life, yeah. Which is go to IIT, then from IIT, try and get into consulting or banking or HUL. To get there, then you realize what the next top job from there is venture capital, then go to that, and then from there, go to an MBA, then come back from an MBA, then try and become a managing director in the next 5-6 years, and then you are set. I think middle class way of thinking and a good way of thinking, honestly, right? It just keeps life simple. But I think fortunately for us, for me personally, when I was at Sequoia Capital, I could get a ringside view of the startup ecosystem. It was very nascent, but it was coming together, right? I mean, and this is fairly, how should I put it? This was intuition led, right? This is all personal experience led. Right? For example, today I look at 15, 16 year old kids, and they're using very different kinds of apps. For example, they're using voice or not, far higher than what my friends use voice. And then you know that they do things that you don't get, that you just don't get, right? The apps they use, the way they sort of communicate, you don't get it, right? And at that point I felt that many people who were say 10, 15 years older than I was back then didn't get it, that the internet will, the businesses, the e-commerce for example, or the businesses will get built online fairly quickly in India. How will it happen? No idea, right? Because all the apprehensions that people had were very valid. How many people are online in India? Nobody discusses this today, but 15 years ago, that was the big elephant in the room, right? How many people are really online and internet is expensive? People don't have desktops. This is when, App Store and mobile phones were just getting started, right? So there are a lot of apprehensions, but your intuition tells you that, this will happen, because I could see that I or my friends were excited about using products and services online. That's how essentially I got started, where I want to do something which is forward looking, not backward looking. And I felt that, continuing on the path that I was on, will not make me personally happy, right? because I want to be part of the future, not part of the status quo. So that's how I got started. And as you can imagine, for anybody, and even today I see my friend having the same, not just my friend, even the young people, many of them, right, who get stuck into, sort of get stuck with their golden handcuff, I'm at McKinsey, then should I leave it? Or I'm at a venture capital fund, should I leave it? And those are very fair questions. I'm glad that I got it, get stuck with that handcuff, because it's genuine. It's a genuine, it's tough to release that golden handcuff. But I think for some reason, call it being naive or not thinking it through fully, listening to my heart, I said, let's do something that will make me happy. May or may not make me rich, but will make me happier. Right? So I just focused on
that. Awesome. No, I think that's so true. Sometimes being naive can help, I think. And it's good to know that, you took that bold bet, right? As opposed to the general route, which is, of course, with all due respect, great for people who choose that, but great to know how you got started. But now coming to
old bet, honestly, right?
Okay.
Even then, it was, the analogy I use very often is like, for me, standing on the ground, somebody doing wall climbing just seems stupid, right? Someone sort of trying to walk Burj Khalifa or some tall building just looks ridiculous, right? Why would you put your life at risk? Yeah. Sort of a thing, right? But to that person, that's not the framework that that person is using, right?
Yeah.
So for me, it was very clear that I will not be happy doing what I was doing.
Right? Yeah.
And it's personal to me.
Yeah.
Right. So if I have to really take a call between having a life that everybody will look at me and question and say, oh, Vikram, you're doing really well, versus, look at Vikram, he started off very well, but, he got behind. I was happy to live with that. Like for me, I could shut the social noise. And when you could, and luckily because I could, then it became very clear that, do what makes you happy.
Yeah.
Right. Then you're not worried that people will say, oh, you're behind, you earn like much lesser than what your friends earn, etc. So yeah, it was not honestly a bold decision. I just listened to my heart. It was like I was at Wharton for my MBA. I dropped out in 6 months.
Yeah.
Right. And it was a decision that I took in 2 days, I think. No sweating over it, no deliberation, no discussion with anybody. Just did it.
it's amazing how simplified you made it sound. But as you said, I think we have to shun those external, comments or validation, right? And I think that's a very important pointer beyond the aspect of building as well. Very important for any founder. But yeah, I think from the outside, it can seem like a bold one. But as you mentioned, like it was more natural for you just listening to yourself and being happy. Wow, that's some deep stuff there already. I think, Vikram, one interesting part of how you started, right? So with Fab Furnish, which was before Cash24, and then with Cash24 as well, there was this constant recognition to how large the market opportunity is, right? And however, somehow, not everybody will have that recognition, right? Because you can be a problem first. And there are all of these other anecdotes that sound well too. But was it purely because of what you knew and because of your past experiences of being in the ecosystem already that you had this recognition that you had to go after large markets? Or was it also very natural? If you could help us understand this aspect of building, right, especially early on, as to how do you perceive how those 10, 15 years, 20 years or 25 years are going to play out for you and how important that first step of planning the market is, I think that would be interesting to gauge.
I think, some of that came through my training, to be honest, right? Which is, having worked at Sequoia, it helped me sort of look at things from a total addressable market, what we all call as TAM. Right? So I think that those were some of the things that we sort of did as a hygiene in terms of our own assessment. But then I should also say that the aspirations were far lower for me personally. We were, I think, very happy to build a company that could be worth $500 million to $1 billion in like whenever it could be. Right? I remember Mehul and I thinking about Cash24 and saying if it's a $1 billion company, it's a great outcome, right? It's an outcome where basically you've lived the journey.
Yeah.
Right? That's sort of the end goal.
Yeah.
So I think it was while we did look at TAM, but our aspirations were also low, right? So I think TAM and your aspirations were hand in hand, right? So I think since the what we are trying to achieve today, where we believe this could be a $50 billion company, would not get answered by the TAM and analysis that we had done back then.
Right.
Then the aspirations are also far lower. Right?
Yeah.
I guess this is sort of the curse of once you start loving the treadmill, right? You want to go faster and you want to go longer. So I think TAM and aspirations go hand in hand.
For sure. And it's interesting to know the humble beginnings because what now it's like in 3 countries. Now you've spoken about how it could be the largest auto company in the country, right? And it's just amazing how far it's come. But yeah, I like that analogy, right? Those aspirations have also now risen. So I think entrepreneurs are more aware, but it's also good to have the recognition that how big can this even get? So the TAM aspect, right? Now moving to, you know, like the problem aspect of it, right? This is something that you've been vocal about in the past, but the problem that you were targeting was a supply side problem with Cars 24 and not essentially a demand side problem, which can be intuitive to some, right? If you can help us decode in your own version as to what this means, right? Why was there an evident supply side problem? And having said that, there were not many incumbents or people who had tried and failed in the business already, right? So how did you get that early conviction of, okay, this is a problem, we're gonna solve this problem in some manner and targeted head on? So if you can walk us through that journey, that'd be great.
Yeah, so I think you know, when we see, I think intuitively we all think ourselves, putting ourselves in the shoes of a buyer.
Yeah.
So even we did that, right? We said, look, if I want to buy a used car, what are my options, right? And then it hit us, okay, where are the cars, right? So when we did this thought experiment of saying, okay, let's start a used car dealership in Gurgaon.
Mm-hmm.
The thing that we got stuck was where will we get the first 10, 15 cars?
Yeah.
Where will we get them from? Like literally, where will we get them from? Other dealers, I mean, why will they give the cars to us?
Mm-hmm.
Consumers is the only choice.
Yeah.
But then, going to consumers is pretty much building a consumer side business. Right? So that's part of how we thought, and our FAFNish experience helped us, because even that turned out to be a supply side problem. But even when we sort of thought about, I mean, so there was some wisdom we had from that experience, but you know, even from our own first principle thinking here, you know, it was very obvious that we had to solve supply first, at least, I mean, you know, wherever we could land with what we thought was the best answer. So that's how we got started, by solving for supply first. And pretty much for 5 years out of 6 years in our existence, we have only solved supply.
Yeah.
To the point that today in Delhi, Bombay, Bangalore, more than 10% of all car sellers are selling their cars to cars.
Yeah. Awesome. No, that's helpful to understand, because yeah, I think keeping your ear on the ground, as they say, right? And then following the natural intuition that followed. But, you know, coming to the solution side of things now, right? Now that you've identified that there's a supply side problem in selling used cars, how do you solve for it? And what was the early PMF like for you, right? I'm sure that establishing a two-sided marketplace where, okay, you're solving for supply, but you had to get the demand, match it. And I'm sure that the first 0 to 100 odd customers or 100 odd cars that were sold, that must have been a magnanimous task. So if you have any stories there, anything that you want to share in terms of how you got that PMF and understood that, okay, this is something that we're going to do for, you know, a large portion of our time and establish this large company around it, that'd be wonderful.
Yeah, I think once we decided that we'll solve supply first,
mm-hmm.
right? I think my co-founder Mehul stepped in, right? Because he knows how to sort of lay down a smart experiment, right? So he suggested, why don't we go and spend a week standing at a petrol pump, right? Because let's say India has 4-5 million car sellers a year,
mm-hmm.
right? Which means that, you know, just divided by 10, right? So you have 400,000, 500,000 car sellers a month, right? Mm-hmm. Then you further do the division by 30, you get the number of sellers a day, right? Mm-hmm. Essentially, the math comes to be that one out of every 40 or 50 car owners are selling their car in that particular month.
Mm. Yeah.
So if you stand at a gas station and you come across 50 car owners who have come to get the car fueled up.
Yeah.
You come across 50, there's a likelihood you'll find one who's actually selling the car.
Yeah.
So he did that simple math. And hence we went and parked ourselves at a petrol pump and started talking to every car owner. Mm-hmm. You want to sell your car, right? And we did that with 50, 100, 150, 200. And we started, the math was checking out, right? So we started getting people who want to sell their car.
Right.
So we were like, okay, now we know the car sellers are there, right? And the second step was, the first thing they asked us, what is the price you will give for the car?
Yeah.
We have no idea. We try to sort of get some industry people who have done this for their life as a consultant and, counseling. And they gave us the prices, but the success was not good, right? Because the consumers were like, thanks for your offer, but we're getting better price elsewhere, right?
Yeah.
And then these people gave us, and the car that we bought on the price that they gave, we turned out to be actually making loss later. Like, because nobody was going to buy that from us at that price. That way we were stuck. Okay, how do you price the cars? So we said, the best way to price a car is to ask people who do it for a living, which is used car dealers. Right?
Yeah.
Not somebody who's sort of a employee of some other company, but somebody who has skin in the game. Right? So we made friends with a couple of dealers and we WhatsApped them some pictures and said, can you tell us the price of the car? There was a huge debate and we were highly skeptical. Why would they entertain us, right?
Yeah.
I mean, they have their own business. But to our surprise, they were responding on every car. Like if we send messages to these two or three dealers, they would not only respond on what price they would give for the car, they would ask us, are there any more cars that you want prices for? And that's when we realized that the problem that we discovered, which is supply, where will you get the supply, is the problem for everybody, not just for us, right? To build a business. Even a used car dealer has the same problem. That where do you get the cars from? Which is why they are very happy to price the cars for us, right? Without the guarantee that they will get the car.
Yeah.
They're pricing the cars with no guarantee that they'll get the car, because getting the car is decided by the seller, whether they want to sell or not, right?
Yeah.
So soon enough, we had a team of 10, 15 people who were all day just calling the dealers and asking them, oh, we bought this car, just WhatsApp you the photos, what would you price it at?
Yeah.
And then we would take the price from 10 dealers, stack the prices up and then say, okay, we'll try and buy the car at the second highest bid. So that even if the first bid backs out, we will hopefully sell the car at a loss.
Yeah.
So this WhatsApp group started scaling and then that converted later into an auction app.
Yeah.
So eventually what we became is a sort of a stock market for used cars, where you have sellers on one side, you have dealers on the other side. The sellers, basically, we take all the car details from the sellers, including the inspection, we put it in the app, and you have this thriving marketplace where these dealers come and bid on those cars. And that's how we started pricing the cars. So pretty much, I think we have the largest and the most active stock market for cars in India.
Yeah, no, that's absolutely phenomenal. When I first read about it, I was like blown away with that entire auction system that you've built. But it's great too. I mean, the cue there is, just like going ahead and targeting the problem head on, and you find the answers and then you keep innovating, iterating on that. So no, that's wonderful to hear all of those early stories, including that, standing at those petrol pumps and selling and using WhatsApp as a means to like just scale, like doing things that don't scale personified there. But, what's interesting is now that you had all of these pieces in the puzzle, right? Like you've mapped all of them. What you did next has basically transformed the entire experience of selling a car, right? Because let's turn back time and 10 years back when we would have to sell a car, I wouldn't know because I was too young, but if my parent would have to, they would have to kind of, spend 6 to 8 weeks, negotiate. It was not a displeasing experience, right? And that's one major thing that Cars24 has changed, because not only efficiently timing it, where I think the process now takes less than 1 hour or even half an hour, but also enhancing the experience where you get into a showroom, inspection is done, you tell about the good things about the car, not just the bad things. And it's a good experience. It's not a liability for the person selling. help me understand, or help us understand rather, as to how was this transformational shift in customer behavior brought on by Cars 24, and how at each step, like any of those anecdotes that you can help us with, did you think that, okay, will the customer even go for this? Are we radically changing too much? Are we doing too many things? Like any of these thoughts, did it ever pop in your head? But how did you radically change customer behavior in a positive manner? That is very, very fascinating for me.
Yeah, I think, you know, we didn't have to change customer behavior, honestly.
Okay.
Because even from a seller perspective, they want to sell their car really quickly.
Yeah.
Nobody looks forward to selling something. You don't wake up on a Sunday and, I'll sell my car to you.
Yeah.
They're actually worried about it. Yeah. However, if you were buying a car, you will wake up on a Sunday and you're like, very excited. Today I'm going to buy my car.
Yeah.
On the contrary, people don't like selling stuff.
Right.
And we very quickly latched onto that, which is why we started marketing to the consumers that you can sell your car in 30 minutes, 15 minutes, very quickly. Right. And, there was a lot of apprehension that used to come from internally, and even consumer research surveys used to say, selling something quickly is selling it cheap. Right.
Yeah.
But I think that's rationalizing. That's rationalizing, but when you actually are in that behavior, you actually want to get done with that very quickly because you don't like it, right? So our focus forever has been that you have to get it done really fast,
right?
Now, of course, that doesn't mean that price will be lower, because consumer will try and get a price as a seller from elsewhere, but our process has to be really fast for it to be a delight, just beyond the price, right? That's what we really focused on, to the point now we are doing pilots in Mumbai for a few months, where we are saying that we will make you a binding offer online without even seeing your car.
Wow.
Make you a binding offer on the app itself, and if you accept the offer, we'll just come and pick the car, right? Of course, we will cross-check that whatever you have declared about the car, it is what it is. But assuming you have made the right declarations, and simple declarations, nothing wrong. We're not asking people to upload pictures and make videos. We're just sort of asking them 15 drop-down questions, right? But if you give us those 15 answers, we will give you the price of your car right then and there. So literally, you have the car price of your car in your pocket, right?
Wow.
So that's what we are trying to do from a long-term perspective. I think people don't like the idea of selling something, the anxiety, whether I'll get the right value, how much time will it take. So we want to just make it disappear from your life. Right? You always have a price. Whenever you decide to click the button, somebody will come and pick the car and take it. And we are doing it already in Mumbai, right? And we'll keep fine-tuning it and then launch it everywhere.
Amazing. I think that's spectacular to hear. And I think, I just love how natural it is, right? In the moment, if you think about it, it's pretty natural. It's not counterintuitive. But as I mentioned, like we want those things, but as you mentioned, we're just rationalizing, right? We don't map it until somebody shows us it's possible. And that Cars 24 has definitely done. Interestingly, Vikram, it just popped up, right? Like all of these processes require a large amount of operational expertise on your end, right? Operational efficiency at the back end that we as consumers perhaps do not see, the sellers do not see, and the dealers also do not, right? So help us understand, how do you ensure a lot of symphony at the background, right? How do you ensure that, okay, everything is happening well? Because while people are selling in a restricted couple of towns, as you had mentioned in the past, you are selling to almost all dealers in the country, right? And there's so much amount of, because these are cars that we're dealing with after all, right? Help us understand that part of the business, right? While I understand it's tech-led primarily, how do you manage the operations and what's the secret to everything running beautifully there? That'll be interesting.
Operations is a nightmare. And we are a bunch of people, my co-founders and I, we take pride in the fact that we are doers, right? And our background has been doing things with our own hands.
Yeah.
So when I was at McKinsey, the projects that I chose were the operation projects. Like I love being at factories, and the internships that I did were again at like standing across a burner and taking temperature checks myself. And same similar for Mehul, Gajen, Richard, right? We all fundamentally think of ourselves as doers.
Yeah.
Right. So we thought it would be a cakewalk for us. It's been super tough at every step, right? I think every 6 months we tell ourselves that we have figured out the operations, and then something else explodes. And then we get on to forming it again, and then something else explodes, right?
Yeah.
In our own mind, we have understated or underpredicted how complex the operations of building a used car business is.
Yeah.
So I can't even explain it to anybody else, because in our own mind we have always underestimated it by a huge mile.
Right.
See, cars are a depreciating asset.
Yeah.
And you have to be very careful with the handling. And our infrastructure is not something that makes life any easier.
Yeah.
So it is a very tough job, right from the time of being able to inspect a car well, because there are hundreds and maybe thousands of different variants of cars, right?
Yeah.
And there are only 7 or 8 brands, but then each of the brand has maybe 4 or 5 lines of cars.
Yeah.
And then over 10 years, they would have had like 20 lines of cars. So we are really talking about being able to inspect well thousands of different kinds of cars. It's hard.
Yeah.
You have to go deep into each car, and then you have to do it 1,000 times.
Yeah.
Then you have to take these cars and put it into a warehouse. In that warehouse, there are rains, there are storms, there are thefts.
Yeah.
The tires are getting flat, the batteries are getting drained out. The heat is causing the glass panes to crack.
Yeah.
Something is going on all the time. And then there's the logistics, right?
Yeah.
How's the driver handling the car? If you're putting on a truck, did you ding something? If you ding something, then how do you repair it? So the whole process is extremely hard.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it seems overwhelming to listen to it. I can't imagine what it feels like to manage it. Any tips, any best rules of thumb, what have you observed has worked well for Cars24 to just make sure it works well?
I think, because we are doers, we took the whole idea of we can handle it manually too far, right? I think looking back, we should have started automating things much earlier.
Hmm.
Because a lot of problems that we created for ourselves were because we were doing things manually.
Right.
And our push back to the team always was, 10,000 cars a month, 10,000 units at the end of the day. Right? I look at food delivery companies, they are handling millions of units.
Yeah.
Why can't you handle 10,000 units in an Excel?
Yeah.
But I think that 10,000 units as a headline number, and this is, maybe say 18 months, 24 months ago, right?
Yeah.
As a headline number doesn't give you the complexity, because it's not 10,000. It's 10,000 into whatever, 300 other attributes that you need to be able to track precisely.
Yeah.
And any attribute going wrong will result in you ending up making a loss on the car.
Yeah.
So I think investing in product upfront is something that many Indian startups can learn from, because the labor is cheap.
Yeah.
I mean, at least for us, we have thrown people at problems pretty often.
Yeah. Fair enough. No, automating early, that's a great cue. But it's amazing and almost mind-boggling that the largest tech companies of the world are actually built at the backbone of crazy operational processes, right? Like take Amazon, for instance. I mean, so much of what they do is background operations running smoothly well to provide customer delight. And what you mentioned, I'm sure it's overwhelming, but it's great how companies like yours can pull it off in a manner that can seem seamless to us, right? As a consumer, we don't have to see any of that and get the customer delight at the end of it. So yeah, no, kudos to that. And just thought, that makes sense to point out. But further, you know, Vikram, like as you scale now, one thing that Cash24 has again done extremely well is the branding side of things, right? We see these quirky ads that make selling a car look very simple. We see this Burj Khalifa launch that happened in UAE a couple of weeks, months back, right? Help us understand how much that plays a role in ensuring that there is enough education in the market about the company, enough customer inflow coming in, because I'm guessing that you're at around 5-6% of the market share right now, right? And there's a long way to go. So if you can give us a good narrative of how much branding matters to ensure trust with the consumer, that would be great.
Yeah, I think branding is honestly to scale faster, right? Because in the initial days, the ROI just didn't make any sense at all. Right? Yeah. For example, in the first full year of our launch, we grew only 50-60%.
Okay.
And we didn't do any branding. We did digital marketing, we didn't do any branding.
Mm-hmm.
The next year, we decided to be a bit bolder and put money in marketing and see how it turns out. But it was spending a lot of money relative to our revenues, right?
Yeah.
And we grew 3x.
Okay.
So, but it still didn't make sense from an ROI perspective, right?
Got it.
Spending more per car on branding than the money that we were making.
Right.
But looking at the other car companies in the world and even in India, you know, even the OEM the largest OEM in India spends incredible amounts of money on marketing.
Right.
And we came to a conclusion, right or wrong, I don't know, but we came to a conclusion that in a business with low frequency like ours, you have to be on air all the time, because it's very hard to tell when a consumer is actually going to come into your funnel. But you can't predict whether you will sell or buy this year or next year.
Yeah.
So I have to be on all the time. Now, the advantage in our business is that you can really get to scale fairly quickly. Because, you know, you don't know, I mean, 10,000 units is $500 million of revenues. And today we are doing like $1 billion of revenues in a year. So the scale you can still get to a large scale that allows you to start. And then your scale allows you to support your marketing expenses. So, and then the larger you get, you can't scale branding at the same level. Right.
Yeah.
I mean, we are amongst the top spenders on television in India today already.
Yeah.
So, you can't outdo that, right? You're already amongst top spenders. Yeah. So you know, the spends relatively stay flat.
Right.
But you keep getting the scale. But you know, initially it didn't make sense. But we had to sort of step out of our way and try the branding anyway. If it had not worked, we would have looked like an idiot, and you know that we sort of wasted so much money, but we went with it and luckily it worked.
No, there's a time and juncture for everything, and for you, like, it evolved over time, and when the ROI makes sense, it has to map with the market especially that you are in. So no, those are great pointers. Further, you know, since we're at the point of scale, it's interesting how fast Cash24 has also grown internationally, and now there's a new demand segment as well, right? Because for the longest time, if I'm not wrong, Cash24 was only focused on the selling aspect of it, right? But now there's a demand side and buying side to things. You've also expanded in the UAE and in Australia, and you're now targeting further international expansion. Now, As we go to that trajectory, how has a founder, your role evolved, and how much of the macro aspect do you have to keep into consideration? And how do these smaller choices kind of take place anyway, right? Like, how do you make these trade-offs between, let's say, depth versus breadth, expansion versus going deeper and things like that, right? If you can give us a quick overview of your thought process when the company is scaling and as you prepare yourself for, let's say, the 5-10 years that lay ahead of us, it would be interesting to understand how a founder at scale thinks.
It's not easy, right? Because the reasons for not doing it are fairly obvious.
Yeah.
Lack of focus, the capital that you allocate on a new project, you could have continued to allocate on India. Still a long way to go in India.
Yeah.
We haven't seen a bad cycle economy-wise for a long time. My own focus, my ability to build a team, I've done the work in international culture, how many Indian founders have built business inside India. So I think all the reasons are very valid, right?
Yeah.
For not doing it. I think the reason for doing it is that you will only find out once you do it.
Yeah.
So I think at some level, being naive about it again helps, because if you will not do it, then of course you have failed anyway in doing something out of it.
Man.
If you try it, at least you will know.
For
us, I think the biggest reason why we decided to take that plunge is that, you know, Mehul and I and Ruchit and Gajin, we have our confidence in our ability to step back.
Okay.
See, if you're building Australia or UAE, we are not building it. You know, it's a team that's building. And in these times, you can't even travel. So even if you want to try and do value addition, you are restricted by your location. So if I'm sitting in India, and Olga, who's my CEO for Australia, she's not going to see me. She has not seen me ever far, except on a video. But I think we take confidence in our ability to step back and let people run the show. We are not, and I should clarify, we are not like that naturally. In fact, we have been control freaks for the longest phase of our lives, but I think we're now beginning to realize that we need to let go of that and we need to focus more on running it in a different way. Instead of trying to do things ourselves, we need to focus more on planning, review, and this is also long-term planning, not like
short planning.
It's a to-do for us, but it's also something that we are confident that we'll be able to pull off, right? Hence, we think that we will see big success, and both our markets are on a trajectory that's way faster than what we have built in India.
Yeah.
I mean, together, we are almost, I mean, by end of the year, probably there will be like 70% of our overall revenues.
Wow.
So they're on a fascinating trajectory. So, but still a long way to go.
Of course. Yeah. No.
Yeah. I think as long as we can keep ourselves in check and stay out of the way, I think we'll be fine.
No, that's brilliant to hear. I think it's so amazing how candid you've been about the fact that some of these things that can help at the start, right? Being a doer or just being a control freak or being executing all the time can also, if not detrimental, you have to hold yourself back at scale to be able to expand for the long run, right? I love that candidness in that acceptance. And I think that's a great learning that can be overlooked and maybe not as intuitive as one may imagine. Further, I want to take just like a couple of minutes solely on a team and culture, right? Since we've not spoken about that subject, we've spoken about the business strategy around it and how you've gone about it. But of course, no great business has been built without a great team. And thus the focus on any nuggets that you might have around how do you hire, how do you scale culture, how do you ensure that, you know, value systems are shared amongst everyone, and that innovative entrepreneurial culture does not go away, especially at scale. I think any wisdom points there on a very abstract level will be very helpful for everyone tuning.
Yeah, there's a lot of talk that's always there about hiring A-class people, etc. Right, but I think A-class people also need a right environment to be A-class. Right.
Absolutely.
And I feel that, especially in India, no startup is hiring like 100,000 people, right? Most of us are like, you know, 1,000, 2,000, maybe larger ones are like 10,000. In a country which is so large, if you're hiring 10,000 people, by design, you are getting the best 10,000, right? You don't, I mean, it's not that hard to, because you put all those filters around its prior experience, etc., right?
Yeah.
What I really try to focus on is the environment we create, right? Because I feel fairly confident that, you know, with all the filters that we apply, we are hiring great people. So the environment is what really matters. And when I think of environment, what I want for myself is a happy place. If I'm going to work 12 hours a day,
yeah,
and if I'm not happy, what's the point, right? Why do people keep going back to their family and you know, attach themselves so important to their family, etc., is because they feel happy with them.
Right.
That's the fundamental truth of life. Right? You want to be around people who make you happy, who you like. Right?
Yeah.
That's what we really focus on, very simply. Right. Create a place where we are happy with each other. Right. So it has few tenets, right? Be respectful to each other. Nobody wants to be in a place where people are shouting and insulting. And are we perfect? No way. Have I sort of never shouted at anybody or misbehaved? Of course not, right? But are we all together getting better and better and probably amongst the top quartile for sure now, right?
Yeah.
So be respectful, try and hold both for and against of an idea in your mind so that things don't become personal when somebody doesn't like your idea. Have a lot of empathy. If somebody is not able to join a meeting at the last minute, don't assume that they are not disciplined, right?
Nah.
There could be a very legitimate reason for not being able to do that, right? So have respect, have empathy, try and hold opposing ideas in your mind, and just genuinely try to help each other as much as you can. So that's sort of really my focus. I want to get up, and that's what you really like, right? For example, if I call somebody on a Sunday, ideally you're like, oh, Sunday is a 50, don't call on a Sunday. But if the person likes talking to you, the person will pick up your call.
Yeah, absolutely.
So when a friend calls, you don't say that it's Sunday or 50, I'm not going to answer. Of course, you're busy a lot.
But if you
see a phone ringing and you had time and you like the person, you will lift the phone and talk, right? That's the environment that we are trying to create internally.
That's amazing. I love the emphasis on the environment aspect and the fact that, you know, you mentioned that you need to create, like, you can hire the best people, but if you're not creating the right environment, it doesn't do any good. And it's great to see that emphasis, and especially on the smaller aspects of, you know, just the anecdotes you mentioned, like if somebody's late, that does not, you can't assume that they might not be disciplined. Wonderful to hear that line of thought, Vikram. Great. I think this has been wonderful, as I want to take the last 5-10 minutes of this conversation to focus on your founder persona. This is a set of similar questions that I asked to each guest on this show, and this is more so personal to how you think, perhaps. But the first question there in the last segment is primarily around how you prioritize and make decisions. While you mentioned that in the past, but you've spoken a lot about trade-offs, and maybe not all of these decisions are, let's say, future oriented or work oriented, right? These could be personal decisions as well. But if you have any mental models around what are variables that you might consider before taking any decision, or what are things that you typically do before taking any decision, that would be very helpful to understand how you think and how you make decisions.
Yeah, of late, what I have learned, and I think that may be more relevant to our scale now, is to try and take lesser and lesser decisions. I think that's sort of the goal that we are focusing on, that try and take as little decisions as possible, because most of the decisions that we take are anyway wrong, right? And that's a combination of not having enough information, of the matter at hand, and be naturally you will be wrong a lot of times. Okay? So one of the things that we are actively trying to do, all of us, is push the decision making down and down.
Nice.
And that has, I genuinely feel that has improved the overall decision making of the company, because 10 people collectively will be wrong lesser than one person taking the decision will be wrong very often.
Yeah.
That's, I think, is the primary thing that we are trying to focus on, to take lesser decisions. And you know, this is easier said than done, because when people call or in a meeting, when people ask, what do you think we should do? The temptation is to answer,
yeah,
right? As opposed to saying, how do you think about it?
Yeah.
So what we are trying to measure ourselves on, okay, how many times we succumb to the temptation and give an answer or give an opinion, as opposed to flipping the question back on the person who's asking the question on, okay, how are you thinking about what decision to take, right? So it's very hard.
Yeah.
And even if we can push ourselves on taking two decisions lesser, I think we'll be fine, right?
Awesome.
And on the decision, that we take, which are obviously, do we do international or not? Should we raise capital or not? Should we make more money now, less money now? Should we launch new category? I think those decisions, you know, they are not made once. So what we do is we write down how we are feeling about the situation. What is the context? What are the pros and the cons there? Go on with it, then revisit it. After a few months, fine-tune it, then revisit it, and so on, right?
Right.
Hardly there are any decisions which are taken, which are set in stone at any point in time. Like,
yeah.
Fortunately, in life, most decisions are reversible,
right,
which is great.
Yeah.
Because then you can experiment more.
Absolutely. Oh, I love that again. I think a lot of, you know, counterintuitive, rather general, as opposed to like intuitive yet counterintuitive wisdom there, because, you know, we can be accustomed to just like make decisions, make things happen, execute. But all of that is like, as you mentioned, don't fall into that trap and like let decentralized decision making. Further, like since you mentioned this, right, like so much of the conversations that I've had on the podcast also revolve around how much does a founder spare time to think and, you know, zoom out, because in the day-to-day, it's very easy to get, you know, caught up with the administrational overload, the execution, the planning processes, all of that. But most of these things are, let's say, short run, but there is a constant double-edged sword to how much you can do on a quarter by quarter basis. Are you reaching the goals and milestones vis-a-vis how what you're doing in the long term? So are there any mental models that you particularly use to, let's say, step back, zoom out, and then let's say look at the larger picture? How do you perhaps do that? Will be very interesting to hear.
I personally feel, at least for myself, that not thinking is actually very, like, you know, it's an excuse to me when I say I don't have time to think and I am just stuck in the daily work. It's basically an excuse for being lazy. Like, you know, not, you're resting and you went for a walk, right? You could very easily rationalize, you couldn't go for the walk because you were prepping for this podcast. Right? So I think it's something that one has to do, whether you have time or not, right? Because how will I learn, right? I mean, when I started building my own company, the biggest realization for me is that I'm an idiot. Right, that I don't know 99.9% of how the world works. Like, I literally know nothing, right? I have thought about everything in life as deterministic, right? There are right answers and wrong answers, but in reality, everything is bloody in between.
Yeah.
So you have to sort of, if you're not learning, then you will go down, but you'll also take your business down with you. So I focus a lot on reading, not just about other startups. I do read a lot about other startups as well, because, you know, it gives you ideas, you learn from them, you get inspired. But over time, I've started reading about everything, philosophy, psychology, history, whatever I'm interested in, because it all adds to you, right? It all sort of helps you think from another lens. So yeah, I think, you know, thinking, it's easy to be lazy and not and I pretend to myself that I don't have time to think. But honestly, if I don't think that I'll not improve, and if I'll not improve, then I'll degrade myself and I'll degrade the company myself along with me.
That's a great point. That definitely, I think that needs to be echoed more and more. And it's applicable across people, I think, not just startup founders. Like, we ought to think about how we are thinking, what are the long-term apprehensions or like repercussions of what we're doing and things like that. But, you know, for the second last question of what has been a great, great conversation, I want to understand what are your, if not mental models, what are your recourse actions in times of distress or adversity, right? Because I'm sure during the way it's not been as easy, or it only gets more challenging, if at all, right? So are there any, what do you do when you're in a position where, let's say, you don't have all the answers, but you're seeking them? What are your models for that? That'd be interesting.
See, when there is stress, when things are not going the way you want them to, essentially the way to get out of that situation is the problem gets solved, right? That's the reason why there is stress or right, the tension in the first place, right? Because you want things to be in a particular way.
Yeah.
Right? And you're not able to get them to be in that way.
Yeah.
So what I practice is share the problem with others in the hope that they will help me solve it, right?
Yeah.
So I have practiced to be vulnerable, right? In front of my co-founders, in front of my team, because they know anyway.
Yeah.
Right? And if they don't know, they will find out eventually.
Yeah.
So you might as well be vulnerable with them and share what the problems are, because when they joined the company, they knew that there will be problems.
Right.
It's not that nobody didn't know that there will be problems, right? So it's sort of now for me become a second nature where I share every small and big problem very openly with the relevant stakeholders. Not from the perspective of trying to tell them that this is your problem, mm-hmm. right? But that, you know, I'm transferring my problem onto you. Mm-hmm. But from the perspective of just being honest about things that we are not doing well, right? Things that where we missed something, things that we could have done better, things where we failed miserably, right? There are like 50 things in the last 6 months that we have screwed royally on. But I can tell you that all of my management, like the top 200 people at least, they all know everything about it. Everything. Because, and I hope that we have managed to create an environment again where we all look at it together as a collective failure, but we don't are also ashamed of it. We make fun of it. We laugh at it, right?
Yeah.
So that's the other part, right? Be vulnerable, but also not create a gloomy environment. We literally practice making fun of each other. I'm not joking. Seriously, right? We make so much fun of each other. Not with my management, because I don't know everybody so closely, but amongst the four co-founders,
yeah,
we internally within the company make so much fun of each other's mistakes,
yeah,
that I hope that it creates an environment where people think that it's fine to make mistakes.
Yeah.
Right? Like if when things go bad, you know, the worst thing that can hopefully happen is that everybody will have a good laugh at it.
Yeah.
Psychological safety is very important, and it starts with me being vulnerable and being able to make fun of my own mistakes.
That's spectacular. I think I absolutely love that, because in a world or in an ecosystem where we are, you know, like looking up to founders and, you know, there's this funding news and all of that, it's very, I think, kind of you to mention that being vulnerable is okay. And that's the way to go, so that you can normalize mistakes and, you know, not have the weight of everything on your shoulder, because it's a collective effort, be it a success or a failure. And there's no pinpointing of problems that somebody caused it. It's about solving it as a together measure and normalizing mistakes by making fun. Wow, those are all amazing pointers.
Funding is a great example, right? Like this fundraise that we were doing right now.
Mm-hmm.
And for this fundraise, I mean, there were tens of hundreds of requests that were coming from investors on this data, this analysis, this is not making sense. But who is going to do it? The analysis is being done by the teams.
Yeah.
So, like, you have to tell the team that we got to give, push this out, you know, otherwise we may miss the bus on this one, right?
Yeah.
And when they realize that they are equally in the game, right? So, whether it works out or not, they need to know an answer because they have anyway worked on it.
Absolutely.
Giving them a real-time update on how things are progressing is very important.
Yeah, that's true inclusion. I mean, that's the true meaning of teamwork after all, right? Like, it takes a village to build a legendary company, and that's a complete example of it. Awesome. I think this is great. For the last question, Vikram, I would hate to get too philosophical, but I will try and normalize it as much as possible. And I would love to understand from you as to what all of this compounds to, right? Like, for you personally and for the company too, if you can break it down for us in a separate manner, like, what's the eventual goal? What keeps you up in the night, or what helps you sleep really well at night? Or what are you looking up to every morning? And what's the long-term vision with Cars24 and for the company too, like, beyond the metrics on a very qualitative level as an entrepreneur, such that everybody listening in, young entrepreneur, enthusiast, or anybody, right, can actually understand how founders kind of think about their companies and what are the core motivations that help them go through this momentous, mountainous ride in such a rather smooth manner, right? Because I've seen founders be okay with the downsides, upsides, and take it as it comes because the journey is so fulfilling, right? So if you can help us understand all of that in all as a parting thought, I think that'll summarize the conversation in the best possible manner.
I think it's evolved over time. When we started with our first startup, it was really the desire to have challenges and overcoming them. What else you do with the life, right? You know, you take on a challenge and then we used to think this is what sports people do, right?
Yeah.
Go on, play a match, and then they play next, and then they play another grand slam. You know, challenges one. Right? And I think that sort of does still give us a lot of kick, and that's why we are together on it after so many years. But I think along the way, we started realizing that, you know, we get a lot of energy and excitement from creating or building a group of people who you really enjoy working with, right? That the older point that around sort of happiness,
yeah,
looking forward to talking to those people, catching up with those people.
Yeah.
Over time, that became very important to many of us, because that's sort of what we are really enjoying, that we are not just hopefully building a large business, but we are also working together in a group of people who really have fun with each other. Because you know what, we are all getting time poorer, right?
Yeah.
We can all make a lot of money, but time will be lesser. So how do you make the best use of your time as well? Not just from a money perspective, but just from being like having a lot and lots of fun, right? So we do hope that one day we'll create one of the largest companies to ever come out of India. I think that sort of just makes us very excited.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, we want to ensure that, you know, 30 years, 40 years down the line, people genuinely, at the time when they can be honest, they genuinely feel that regardless of the outcome, whether we became one of the largest companies to come out of India or not, they had the best time of their life. Right? They felt respected, they felt cared for, they could do their best work, they enjoyed each other's company, they had fun. Right? They're in a good company.
Yeah. Wow. No, that's amazingly simplified, and I love that goal. Thank you so much, Vikram, for an absolutely amazing conversation. I absolutely loved it, and I hope you enjoyed it too. I'm super confident that this is going to be very helpful for everyone tuning in. Thank you so much again for taking up the time.
Thank you. I love this. Thank you so much.